Pervaded pervade the entire universe. I'm the human in principle. I pervade everything. Just as gold pervades all the ornaments, you see, or clay pervades all the parts. So also Lord Krishna says that I pervade the whole universe. So this ornament is not separate from gold. So also the universe is not separate from Ishvara. So important that just as ornaments are manifestation of gold, you see, gold itself manifests ornaments, the clay itself manifests pots and pans, the cotton itself manifests so many cloths, or the water manifests many waves. So also Ishvara manifests this universe. It's a very important thing that in order to worship Ishvara, you need not go anywhere, any place else. What is in front of you, including yourself, is Ishvara. Therefore, Ramana Maharshi says, Jagat Ishadhi Yukta Sevanam Ashtamurti Vrut Deva Pujanam. Worshipping Ishvara with the attribute that it is Ishvara. Worshipping Jagat with the attribute that it is Ishvara. So, therefore, Jana Seva is Jana Adana Seva. Because Jana Adana, Ishvara is no different from Jana. He pervades everything. He is the self of all. Now, when you say that, then a question arises, Swamiji, Ishvara is the self of all. He pervades everything. Like the gold pervades all the ornaments, gold is the self of the ornament. So also, Ishvara is the self of you and I. So where is it? Not far at all. Next question arises, Swamiji, if you say that Ishvara is my Atma, myself, then I was born, I'm growing old, someday I will die. Does that mean that Ishvara also is born? He is also growing old. He also, you say, yeah, Ishvara is everywhere. Swamiji, this thief, Ishvara is his Atma also, and a murderer. Ishvara is the Atma also, and a sinner, Ishvara is his Atma also. You will not accept when he says that I pervade the entire universe. That means that he is the self of all. See, gold, whether ornament is beautiful or ugly, gold has no problem. Gold is the self of ornament. Is beautiful or ugly? Small or big? Gold does not discriminate at all. Similarly, Ishvara says that, Lord Krishna says, I am the self of all. But then Swamiji, when a thief commits a theft, does it mean Ishvara commits a theft? If a sinner commits a sin, does Ishvara commit the sin? If a person dies, does it mean Ishvara dies? So the second line of that verse says, Matsani Sarabhutani Nachaham Teshavastitah. Matsani Sarabhutani. All the beings are in me, I am not in them. There is a little change here. All beings are in me, I am not in them. Meaning that the relationship between Ishvara and Jagat is somewhat different from relationship between gold and ornament. Gold is ornament, no doubt. When you beat up the ornament, you are beating up the gold. When you melt the ornament, you are melting the gold. So whatever happens to ornament happens to gold. But here, Lord Krishna says that I manifest as a universe all right, but universe is in me, I am not in them. You know, it is something like this, like an actor performing variety of roles. Imagine an actor performing role of a beggar, of a king, of a minister, of a hero, of a villain. An actor can perform a variety of roles, right? So actor can say, I am the self of all. Who is beggar? That is also actor. Who is a king? That is also actor. Who is minister? That is also actor. Who is the villain? That is also actor. and the self-abode, I pervade all of them. But they are in me, I am not in them. Meaning what? I manifest as king, as beggar, as minister, but I do not become the king, manifest, beggar. You know the difference is, when a real beggar is begging, he is begging. But when the actor is performing the role of a beggar, he is begging and still not begging. You know, when the actor performs the role of a beggar, he is begging all right. From whose standpoint? From the standpoint of the spectators. He is not begging. From whose standpoint? From his own standpoint. He is performing the act of begging. He is begging, still not begging. Meaning that, as a result of becoming, as Swamiji says, as a result of becoming a beggar, he'll become richer actually. You know, by becoming beggar, that will become richer. So, he's begging all night, but not begging. Because he only has taken the role of beggar, he has not become the beggar. So therefore, where is the beggar? He is an actor in the role of a beggar. Where is the beggar? Beggar is only in his costume, not in his person. You follow? So when the beggar begs, hey, this actor is multi-millionaire person. I mean, he's begging here. If somebody takes him to be a real beggar and goes and gives him a penny or a quarter or something like that, that would be ridiculous. It's not so, because I give him a quarter, he can give quarters to a million people like me, you know. And so, important thing, that he is the self-beggar, all right, but he has not become the beggar. So what's the relationship between actor and beggar? Beggar, well, Swami's equation is there, you know. Actor A, beggar B. B is equal to A, but A is not equal to B. Meaning what? The beggar is not apart from actor, but the actor is apart from the beggar. Beggar is dependent upon the actor is independent of the beggar. Is that right? You know, the beggar cannot be without the actor. The beggar cannot be without the actor, but the actor is independent of the beggar. Is not so, because even when the beggar is not there, the actor is there. Actor can be king also, beggar also, he can be anything. He can be in none of their roles. So beggar is dependent, actor is independent. Beggar is incidental, actor is essential. In Vedantic language, beggar is a superimposition upon the actor. You know what is superimposition? Imposing an idea. Actually, he is a multimillionaire. Upon him, you impose an idea of a beggar. Beggar is not real. In Vedanta, it is called mithya, is as though beggar. Therefore, even when he is begging, he is crying all right. As a beggar, he is crying. But he is not crying. His real tears are coming out within himself. What does he say? How wonderful, you know, that I'm crying. Inside he will be smiling. Because of the effect, you know, of the acting, inside he will very, very smile. So, similarly also Lord Krishna says, Matsthani Sarabhudani Nachaham Teshavastitah. All the beings are in me, I am not in them. Just as the actor can say, the beggar is in me, I am not in the beggar. Meaning beggar is dependent upon me, I am not dependent upon the beggar. Beggar cannot be without me, I can be without the beggar. Beggar is because of me, I am not because of beggar. So also, the universe is because of Ishvara, but Ishvara is not because of the universe. The universe is a superimposition, is mithya. Ishvara is satyam, the actor is satyam, the beggar is mithya. So also universe is mithya, Ishvara is satyam. Then he further says, so having shown the relationship between Ishvara and this Jagat, that Ishvara is satyam, Jagat is mithya, just as actor is satyam, beggar is mithya, actor is real, beggar is superimposition, So also Ishvara is real, the Jagat or the creation is superimposition. And further he says, Nacha Matsthani Bhutani Pashyame Yogam Ishvaram. Yes, Arjuna, in fact the beings also are not in me. First of all he says, they are in me, I am not in them. Then he says, they are not in me. When the actor goes to green room, he takes out all his costumes. At that time, there is no beggar, there is no king, there is no minister, there is no villain, there is nobody there. He is in fact one without. How many people are there? Next question is, how many people are there? There is one actor there, one beggar there, one beggar is there, king is there, minister is there, villain is there. How many people are there? King, beggar, minister, villain. How many?
Four.
So now, suppose you want to offer him a cup of tea. How many cups of tea will you order?
One.
You said four. Are there four or one?
One
appearing as?
Four.
One appearing as?
Four.
One Ishvara appearing as? All these names and forms, understand? One appearing as many. One actor can take some number of roles. In his lifetime, he has taken hundreds of roles. But Ishvara is a much bigger, he is called Nataraj, you know, Bhagavan. He is called Nataraj. He is the king of all the actors. So he has taken all his roles simultaneously, understand? Who am I? Ishvara manifesting as a Swami. Ishvara manifesting as you, as him, as her, as everybody. Simultaneously, one is manifesting as many. So this is how. Therefore, what happens? In order to know Ishvara, where should you have to go? Nowhere, in my own self. So Bhagavan Ishvara has put on this costume of a Swami. Like an actor puts on the costume of a beggar. And people think that he is a beggar. But really, similarly also, people think that this person is a Swami. This is X, this is Y, this is Z, you know. This one is Ashoka, this one is Sri Rama, is Krishna, is Yadava, is Madhava, is Govinda, is Sridhara. And not Bhagavan, these are people's names. They are all right. But in reality, who are they? In reality, they are nothing but Bhagavan manifesting in those forms. See, this is a very important thing. Because when we understand that, it gives a certain attitude. How do we relate to the world? How do we interact with the world? This world is manifestation of Ishvara. Ishvara alone manifests as world. Therefore, world is the place of worship. You always worship Ishvara, is it not so? The world is not the place of extracting pleasure, is not exploiting. But it is place of worship. Therefore, Lord Krishna says that perform your actions in the spirit of worship to Ishvara, the spirit of worshipping Ishvara in the form of this Jagat. Therefore, karma yoga. Ishvara pervades everything. Everything manifested in Ishvara. Therefore, now today that I don't see that. Even though what is Ishvara, still it is not my perception. Why? Because I am so much identified with this one Upadhi that I look upon everybody is separate from me. I am this much alone, everything outside the body is separate from me. This is my present perception. The reality is what? I am the center of all. What you are is what I am. So Lord Krishna says in the Gita, 5th chapter, Vidya Vinaya Sampanne Brahmane Gavihasthini Sunicheva Svabhagecha Pandita Samadarsina. Imagine there is a pious Brahmana who is very learned and very humble, sattvic person. There is a cow, the elephant, a dog, an untouchable. From sattva, rajas, tamas, all the personalities are there. Pandita Samadarsina. the wise people see them all is one, meaning that self is one alone. Meaning one self, one Ishvara is in the form of, in the visha of, in the costume of Brahmana, whether it's a cow, whether it's an elephant, a dog, whoever it is. Therefore, as our Kabirji says, Ghata Ghata Mevo Sairamata Katuka Vachanamatabo Ghata Ghata Mevo Sairamata. Sai means Swami. Swami means Ishvara. Ghata Ghata Me. Ghata means in a pot, means in the heart. In every heart, He is manifesting, the Lord is manifesting. Katuka Vachanamatabo. Therefore, do not use harsh words for anybody. Don't use bitter words for anybody. Meaning that, do not hurt anybody. So Lord Krishna says in the 6th chapter, Atmopamyeva sarvatra samam pasyati Arjuna sukham vayadeva dukham sa yogi paramamatah. If you want to become paramayogis, doing what we are doing, for becoming supreme yogis, we don't have to do anything different. Living the life that we are living and doing what we are doing, all that we need to do is one simple thing. Treat other people as you treat yourself. That's all. Treat other people as you treat yourself. Sukham vayadiva dukham. For example, I would never want to make myself unhappy, right? I would always want to make myself happy. And I would never want to make myself unhappy. Well, same attitude for others also. Seek to make others happy and avoid making others unhappy. You become a yogi. You know the yogi in Samadhi? That kind of yogi we can become. A simple rule. Treating others as we treat ourselves. Do not do unto others what you do not want to be done to you. And do unto others what you like to be done to you. You want other people to be kind to you, compassionate to you, loving. That's what you want other people to do to you. Others also expect the same thing from me. So let me be also kind, compassionate, loving to others. I don't want anybody to be cruel to me. I don't want anybody to hurt me. I don't want anybody to lie to me. I don't want anybody to cheat me. Right? So don't lie. Don't cheat. Don't hurt. Because self is one. Therefore, whatever I am is what you are. Whatever my expectations are from you, they are expecting you, same expectation you have from me. That being the case, so this is first lesson. That Ishvara is the self of all. That is the basis of karma yoga. Sva karmana tvabhyacha siddhim vindati manavah. So, worshipping the Lord by your karma, perform every action, what action? Anything that you do, even simple mundane actions, whether cooking, cleaning, whatever we do, or you are a physician, you are an engineer, you whatever actions you perform, whatever role Ishvara has given to us, in short, Ishvara has given everyone a role. Therefore, we are in certain station of life, certain conditions, and what it does, no role is bigger or no role is smaller. No action is bigger, no action is smaller. Therefore, whatever you are going to perform, do that. Do that with, do that with love. And do it in such a manner that it becomes an offering to Ishvara. Svakarvana tavabhyacha. So, all the day you can perform worship of Lord. Whole day we can't be in the puja room. Whole day we cannot offer flowers. That you can do for a period of time. This whole time, what do you do? Every karma also becomes a flower. Svakarvana tavabhyacha. Om. Govindaya namaha, Achyutaya namaha, Anantaya namaha, Govindaya namaha. Perform every action as an offering to Lord. So this vision of Ishvara that Lord Krishna gives becomes the basis of our life. Pita hamasya jagatah, mata dhata pita mahah. I am the father, I am the mother, I am the grandfather. I am everything. And therefore, I am also all parts of yajna also. Lord Krishna says that as a son, I heat up the whole world, I withdraw the water for 8 months and give out rain as 4 months. He is alone doing everything. This is all his glories. And we are all nothing but Ishvara in this particular costume, in this particular form. So with this understanding, we have to live our life. So what is called bhakti? This is called bhakti. Keeping this in mind and living the life is bhakti. Because bhakti is when Ishvara is in our life. When what we do becomes an offering to Ishvara. So whatever we do, anena parameshvara priyata. May Ishvara be pleased by this. So that's the attitude. And treat others as you treat yourself. So while interacting with other people, we can ask ourselves the question, how would I like to be treated if I was in that position? Even if somebody has hurt you, that is all the reason for you to get angry, to punish that person. But before you punish, ask yourself, if I was in that position of that person, would I like to be punished or forgiven? No, I would like to be forgiven. Then forgive that person. Be kind to that person. I want others to be kind to them. Be kind to them. So this is the basis of life, based on the vision of Ishvara that is presented by the Lord in the Bhagavad Gita. So that is a preliminary remark. No questions.
We are having a Pran Pratishtha in the temple. What is the significance there? You can explain it.
Pran Pratishtha, infusing life. Infusing life. So what we have are the deities, the murtis or images, murtis made of stone, sometimes matter, sometimes wood also, whatever they are. So before the ceremony they are nothing but the stone images, that's all they are. So what is in the Prana Pratishtha is infusing life. Making them chaitanya, making them alive. How do you do that? By performing different ceremonies. So one of the ceremonies they will perform is they will perform different kinds of homas, different kinds of rituals will perform, At that time, they will also install a number of water pots. In these different water pots, they invoke different devatas. And they do the worship of that devata. At the same time, the main deity also, they are performing homa for all of them also, and also that water becomes sanctified. Sometimes they do it for 3 days, 2 days, 1 day, usually a 3 day function is there. Different homas are performed, and pujas are performed, sanctification, invoking devatas, different devatas in those water pots. So water becomes sanctified. So day of Prana Pratishtha, you pour that water upon the god. That's the main ceremony. Another thing is that they also have tied thread from Yajnashala all the way up to the deity there. And the power is transferred from here to the deity. The idea of power, transferring the power and infusing life. So then once that is done, is no more a stone, it is now devata, alive devata. That's how then we can worship the devata.
Is this not a question but an expression? This shloka, Vidya Vinaya Sampanne Brahmanega, is a very clear cut injunction from Bhagavan Krishna to look at these different hath, cow, elephant, and shavpake. But how come our many of our dharmacharya themselves start with discrimination, untouchability? This injunction, when I read this shloka, I was upset that there could not be any clearer injunction treating all them fairly and equally. But we didn't do it.
Well, that is our mistake if we did not do it. What it says is this. It says, Brahma Panditaha Sama Darshina. You see them all equal. You treat them according to their position. You respect them all equally, but treat them according to their position. Meaning you treat a Brahmana as a Brahmana should be treated, a cow as a cow should be treated, a dog as a dog should be treated, but with the same love. But that doesn't mean that Brahmana comes and I will offer him the seat. A dog, I will offer a seat, you know, because a dog is to be treated differently. So in the Vyavahara, we have to respect the differences existing. That a man is a man, a woman is a woman. Young is young, old is old. Animal is animal. Bird is a bird. Although inside them the same Ishwar. So we respect them all equally in our mind. But in Vyavahara, we have to treat them all differently. That is all the... It's not discrimination. Division of work according to the people's capacity. Because everybody is born differently. Everybody has different capacities, different aptitudes, you know, different likings, different dislikes. So depending on the personality, if you assign them the appropriate duty, then there will be a harmony between the person and the work. Just as here also, when you go for hiring somebody, you always take a qualified person for that particular position. That doesn't mean other people are useless, but they are good for other positions. So you put an accountant in accounting position, engineer in engineering position, this and then, you know, every different positions. So treat them equally does not mean that you treat them in the same way, but respect them all. So in your perception, it's not that doctor is higher than an engineer or higher than even a laborer. You respect in your mind equally, but at the same time, you place them which is in the position that is appropriate to them.
The other question, Shubha Shubha Parityadi. What has exactly... You shouldn't have any notion of good and bad or...
No. Description. This is a description of a wise person. Shubha Shubha Parityadi. One was given up all the actions, Shubha and Ashubha, Punya and Papa, virtue and vice. Who has transcended both of them? So this is a distinct person who has transcended both virtue and vice. Meaning that he, for a virtuous person, vicious person is the same kind of feeling. In his mind there is no discrimination, there is no hatred, there is no such, you know, same kind of feeling for everybody. Equally treating them, everybody equally.
But should you avoid Ashubh situation or Ashubh?
No, what we should do is that Ashubha must be conquered with Shubha. First step is Ashubha means the vicious actions, sinful actions. And Shubha means virtuous actions. Ashubha means Papa, Shubha means Punya. So, Punya Papa. But then first in our life, we should have Punya Karma. With which we overcome Papa. With knowledge then you overcome Punya also. You go higher than that also. Yes, Swami.
But we don't treat them the same, Shubha and Ashubha, Parityagi.
No. You see, Shubha and Ashubha, it is ego who performs the Shubha Karma and Ashubha Karma, right? Shubha Karma, virtual action. Ashubha Karma, vicious action. Both actions are performed by the ego. Now, when you come to know that you are not the ego, you are consciousness, you are Brahman that transcends the ego, then you are not performer of either Shubha Karma or Ashubha Karma, both of them you transcended. So Shubha, Shubha Parityagi means one who has transcended both Shubha and Ashubha. He has transcended his ego. And therefore, he does not have this notion that I am performing the action. So when you have this notion that I am performing action, then action can be Shubha or Ashubha. Then of course you should avoid Ashubha and perform Shubha. When you don't have this notion of ego, then not doing anything. Sakarta means the actionless. Shubha, Shubha Parityagi, one knows himself as actionless.
Swamiji, one common question comes in our Gita Vichara class. So whenever we are in that 1.5 hours, we meet, everything seems to be logical and working. But by the time we go to the car and parking lot and go, things go back to our habitual thing. So how do you, so one of the common question is this just the theory that we are not able to put in practice? And so it's a common question that we come across.
Something that we need to know on our part. I'll tell you a story that our Badaswami used to say, you know. Swami Chinmayananda used to tell a story, which I often tell. He would give talks, you know, lectures to large audiences. Once he was giving lectures in Bombay in the Sardar Patel Stadium. A number of people, hundreds of people are listening to him. And there are always those who are his long-time devotees. They always sit in the front row and they know him very well. They have listened to him a number of times. They know what he's talking about. They enjoy it. So one day somebody complained to Swami. Swamiji, look at your devotees. They're sitting all sitting in the front row. They're listening to your ears together. And they all enjoy what you're saying. They understand what you're saying. But have you seen their behavior when they leave the stadium, when they come to bus stop? Have you seen how their behavior is? So then Swamiji says, so Swami replies this question with a story. He says, one Sunday morning, this man is reading his newspaper. It's a Sunday, it's a holiday, he's reading newspaper relaxed. Then a thought comes in his mind, I wish to have a cup of coffee. So then he calls his wife from where he's sitting, she's in the kitchen. He says, may I please have a cup of coffee? She said, okay. In 5-7 minutes, she prepared a cup of coffee. This saucer, you know, in India, saucer, a cup, a spoon, all given to him. He is still absorbed in reading newspaper, so he keeps his coffee and starts sipping. The coffee is bitter. So he says, one sip, second sip is bitter. Then he gets a little upset with his wife. If you try to forget this, put sugar in there. How many times did I tell you that I like coffee with sugar? And you again forgot it? You don't pay attention at all. Like that he started shouting. So she came out and said, what's the matter? You have your forgotten sugar again. She says, look what I have given you. What have I given you? A saucer, right? Yes. A spoon, right? Yes. What's the purpose of spoon? What is the spoon meant for?
Sugar is in there.
One for what? For stirring. Sugar is there, you need to stir. So Swami says, I pour sugar in them. They have to stir.
Yeah.
So sugar which is inside, the coffee will become sweet only when the sugar is stirred. So when you are Gita Vishaya Guru, or when you are in satsang, when you attend the talks, it's like putting sugar in us. And we have to stir that, assimilate that. Meaning that, this knowledge should not just remain confined to a certain idea, but we have to then see what we learn today, how does it apply to me in my life? You do see that. So suppose today we said that Ishvara is self of all. What does it mean to me? That means that my spouse also is Ishvara's manifestation. My children also is Ishvara's manifestation. My in-law also, my relative also, my friend also. Some of them I don't like, some of them I hate, but I remind myself, they are all manifested in Ishvara. How should I treat them in my mind? So outwardly you may treat them as appropriate. Your son you treat in one way, your spouse you treat in a different way, parents you treat in a different way, because they all have different status in life. In your mind, the same kind of respect, same kind of compassion, same kind of love. So whenever any idea of hatred comes, I remind myself, wait a minute, who am I hating? Hey, this is Ishvara's manifestation. Who am I hating? When a jealousy comes, who am I jealous of? So like that, whenever any negative thoughts come, I remind myself about what I have learned, try to neutralize those thoughts. That's how, when we try to apply this in our day-to-day life, then this knowledge becomes assimilated. Otherwise it remains at the intellectual level. So we are good. When you talk, we can talk. But when it comes to our life, it does not show up. Because this is assimilation, it's called assimilation.
How do you...
Because when you eat the food, it goes to stomach all right, that's not enough. It will digest it, assimilate it there. And then alone it really helps the body. Why it doesn't help? So much food is eating, nothing happens to him because the stomach doesn't digest, the food all goes out. It must be assimilated. Digested and assimilated.
You know, when you're doing things, you're supposed to do it for God or whatever, right? How do you get that feeling when you're doing our day-to-day life? Because we are not thinking that way. You know, maybe when we're doing puja, we are, you know, in that reverential mood. But in a day-to-day stuff, you know, though you may accept whatever you get is prasada, but in doing it, we are not thinking that way. How does, because that transcends everything, right? If you think that way, then you will know. How do you achieve that?
You know, we have to train our mind. And what we can do is, we can in the morning set aside 15-20 minutes and go through the routine of the day. And the important tasks that I am going to do during the day, you tell the mind, look mind, when do this task, remember, you are doing it for Ishvara. That task, remember, doing it for Ishvara. So, it is some important tasks which we do every day. We remind our mind in the morning, we actually rehearse and educate the mind and ask the mind, remember this. Mind may forget. In the evening, again you review. How many times I remember? I forgot every time. Doesn't matter. Next morning. Next morning. Like this, day in, day out, because when we are in heat of activity, you know, November. But when you are in quiet, you know, in the morning, that time you can put your, you can educate the mind. Then by educating number of times, then mind will remember. Hey, it is Ishvara Bhakti, Ishvara Bhakti. It goes up and comes.
Swamiji, one more thing. Aniketa, same just. 12th chapter, homeless. Yavakta Same Priya Bahu is Aniketa. What does exactly homeless mean?
So, one of the attributes that a devotee has is Aniketa. Niketa means a dwelling or a home. Aniketa, one who does not have a home. Meaning that one who does not call anything as my home. Wherever he is, it is home. He doesn't have any particular home. You follow? So wherever he is at home. He is not attached to a given place as his home. Wherever he is equally. So we are comfortable when we are at our home. We are comfortable when we are at our home. Not so comfortable when we are outside. But this wise person is comfortable at home, wherever he is, in at home. There is no attachment to any place. That his mind is not mine. That's what it means.
Continue your questions.
Yes. That is what he has told us so far.
Swamiji, that means homeless is better than the homeowners.
Not better, I don't have to pay mortgage.
It's not homeless the way we see. Home is everywhere, here and now. You are the mandir, that is your home.
Another question, Swamiji, like you said, treat everybody equal, you know, what would you be treated like? But when you go somewhere, you know, there are people who always complain, talk about bad about you. It's very hard to treat them, you know. Very, very difficult, you know, even though you are positive, you talk about positive things, but they keep on bringing the point again and again. How do you deal with that? How do you treat them as equal as you want to be treated?
Well, here a two-step approach. One-step approach is When they criticize you, when they talk bad about you, then the natural reaction of, perhaps doing the same thing to them or disliking them. That's the first approach, or first impulse. But the two-step approach is, rather than responding to the behavioral person, look at the person behind the behavior. Why does the person criticize? There's some problem within themselves. The person is critical, criticizing others because some kind of pain is there within themselves. A person is happy, you will never find him criticizing anybody. An unhappy person does that. So rather than looking at the behavior, look at the person behind the behavior. Then you know there is a painful person, person pain is talking like this. So have sympathy for him. That's how you do. Try.
Needs a lot of patience.
Again, training.
Training.
You'll fail a number of times. Mm. But then try again and again and again and again. And then the mind will say, wait a minute. See the behavior, person behind the behavior. In the beginning, we just respond to the behavior. But every time we remind the mind, then again, someday mind will remember, there is a person behind the behavior. Like that, it will slowly happen. And particularly, you can practice this with the people with whom you have difficulty.
Not me.
That's yes to decide.
He is very easy to deal with. Because half of the time he's into the book, he doesn't hear what I'm saying.
So, as I say, so there are some people we meet every day. Certain things repeat themselves. Same people, same kind of behavior, same kind of reactions happen every day. Then we can, as I said, meditate in the morning and visualize that person. That now I am going to meet that person. That person will behave like this, talk like this, act like this. Then you tell your mind, mind, what are you going to do? You're not going to react. You're going to look at the person behind the behavior. Have compassion for the person. In the morning, so there are 2-3 people like that, not many hopefully, So every day 2-3-4 people may be there. Your boss may be there. Some colleague may be there. Some difficult people may be there. So visualize them in your mind. And train and rehearse and train the mind. You can forget when the time comes. Do it again and again and again. This way we can train the mind to maintain poise in the actual situation.
Or change yourself.
That's easy to do.
That is called changing myself. Changing my mind is changing myself. Mm-hmm.
One concept that is difficult to grasp is Brahman. Mm. In Nishin there was unmanifested Brahman. And then from that creation forces Ishwara, Hiranyagarbha, and where does Maya come here into Ishwara? And then that is a tough concept.
As you say, one appears as many.
Correct.
Why does not become many? It is by Maya that the actor appears as a beggar. See, he remains a multi-millionaire person and still appears as a beggar. How come? What makes him do that? You can call it Maya. By Maya. Maya means appearing as different from what you are. So by Maya, he appears as a beggar, appears as a villain, appears as this, that, and this. So Ishvara appears along this. So appearing to be different from what you are is done by Maya. Magic. Like a magician takes a piece of paper and shows a $100 bill. That's called magic. That's called Maya. So Ishvara also is one, but appears as many.
we see that as Maya or Ishwar does a Maya?
Ishwar has Maya.
Ishwar Maya.
But we can delude it. When we see the magic show, we think it's really happening there. Similarly, Ishwar is doing, we think that really he has become magic. In fact, he is appearing as magic.
Now, another question that comes up in Gita, Gita class is why? Why this magic?
Why not? Magic is just a play. It is play. So, suppose you are playing tennis.
Mm-hmm.
Why only six sets, you know?
Why only one ball?
You see, one very wealthy person, some people from city approach, he comes, he is in the village, but a very wealthy person. Some city people wanted to build a stadium. They approached him and he was very generous. He donated for the stadium. Still open, the soccer game being played. And this man is invited, you know, and he watched it with him. After half an hour, 45 minutes, he says, what are you fellows doing here? Why are these fellows fighting? Why don't you give them each a ball, you know? Why are they fighting? It's called sports. There's no reason. In cricket, why only 22 yards between the two stumps, you know? Like that. So, sports means there is no reason. Similarly, if it is real, then the reason would be there. If you really became this, there would be no reason. It is not real. For real, unreal, there is no reason.
Why did Brahman want to be manifested in so many? What was the reason for him to manifest in so many?
He just talked about it.
That's why the question comes up.
But if he really became this, then the question would have been appeared. He is just appearing like that. He's called Leela or Krida.
But he didn't have any need to do that.
No?
He was bored otherwise.
No bored, nothing. When you are playing, what's the need? Sport, there is no need. It's just out of joy that you do that. Out of joy, Ishwar manifests in this manner.
In the I think the Mundaka Upanishad means that the dissolution and the world is recreated. It is the sum total of all the karana, sharira, which is, makes people manifest. Sum total of all the karana, and they are manifesting to continue their vasanas and take the body and continue their journey. Till they reach the moksha, something like that. But that's in a samsara level, not at the Brahman level. Swamiji, that is
guided meditation. Guided meditation 15 minutes in the end when you do it. This okay?
She asked me that in answer. Guided meditation.
15 minutes at least.
This is all fall asleep.
Even
having come after the food, they are always sleepy. So meditation, we can have some bhajan.
Okay.
Meditation, they really fall asleep, they are always sleeping.
Okay.
Is meditation. Yeah.
Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram
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 Yeah. Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.